Yeah, we will start to record now. So it's my great pleasure to be in possibility to announce our fourth lectures and our fourth lecture in our SEENET-MTP seminar, which was started in January with John Ellis as the first lecturer. Now, after some, we have a vacant place in April, unfortunately, but now we are continuing with Professor Emilian Dudas, who was born in Romania and who did his PhD in Paris in 1994. Emilian, I find that you are at Orsay from at Palissot from 2004. I hope that I'm not wrong. You are professor there. And I would like to say that Emilian Dudas is very well known in the world and appreciated by his results mostly in the string theory, extra dimensions, phenomenology, string theory phenomenology, but also he contributed to many, many different fields. Related to SEENET-MTP, Emilian was one of the first persons who joined our scientific advisory committee and participated in many workshops and schools, and I would like to thank him again for all this contribution and hope we will see each other as many of our members in Belgrade in the beginning of September. Anyway, today we have a opportunity and pleasure to have a talk, some issues with gravitinos in high scale SUSY models. And I would ask Emilian to start his talk. After the talk, there will be some time reserved for So, Emilian, thanks again, and please, you can start your talk.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for the introduction, Goran. First of all, it's a great pleasure to give the talk here in front of my former colleagues, advisor, one of my former colleagues from Bucharest, Goran, other friends. So it's really a privilege. Thanks very much for the invitation. So the talk is about some issues, some which were raised recently with one particle which is characteristic of supersymmetric models, which is the gravitino, which is the partner of the graviton in what are called supergravity series. So I'll try to present first of all the context, why we are interested in such a problem, and then I will. Do you hear me, Goran?
Yes, I hear you very well. I guess that everybody hear you very well.
Okay, very good. And. I start with the context why we're interested in this, and then I'll go to some concrete results and some prospects. So this is based partially on a published work last year with Marcos Garcia, Jan Mambrini, Kisolif Peloso, and Sarunas Werner. So these are people partly from Minneapolis, Orsay, and Padova. And work in progress was with my former PhD student, Quentin Bonfoy, who is right now in Hamburg, but will go to Berkeley very soon. And my current PhD student, Gabriele Casagrande, which he just started recently the PhD. So that's the outline. So first of all, with a kind of a motivation, why these days, why it's more interesting to study such problems this day than a couple of years ago. It's related to a certain program which was initiated by Kumrun Wafa, which is called the Swampland program. So I try to define very, very briefly to remind you what the program is, and then in which sense the gravitino, it's a good ground to study, to put it together in such a program. Then I'll go to the main object we'll study, which is essentially the propagation of the gravitino, the propagation in some time-dependent background, which would be essentially inflation-type background. But as I'll argue later on at the very end, the problem that we are discussing is more general. It's not really a phenomenological problem. It's more like a conceptual consistency problem where I'm mostly interested right now. And then in section three, I'll give you some concrete results. And then I'll try to argue that we can understand the constraint of the propagation of gravitino from other viewpoints which are related to causality. So essentially, the kind of constraints we'll discuss about will the fact that the propagation of this particle gravitino can become acausal in some setups, which mean that the setup is probably inconsistent, and that's why we relate it to this program, which is called Swampam program. So that's the outline. So first of all, let me, since somehow the context is the quantum gravity, let me remind you, start with some very general remarks. So first of all, the Einstein general relativity is a classical theory. As we know, the mass and the energy deforms the space-time. So we have a space-time geometry, which describes gravitational interaction. The quantization of gravity done in the standard sense lead to ultraviolet divergences, which cannot be reabsorbed in a finite number of parameters. So the standard quantization of gravity leads to a non-normalizable theory, which is a problem. The fact that gravity is non-normalizable is not a problem at low energy, because the coupling of gravitational interaction is related to the energy divided by the Planck mass, which is the strength of the gravitational interactions. So the quantum corrections are negligible at low energies, but as we all know very well, at high energies, very high energies, or in strong gravitational fields, like close to black holes, the theory of quantum gravity is necessary. Goran, do you see my mouse moving?
Mouse, no, but this indicator, yes.
Okay, so let me start with the context, why I'm interested particularly now on some consistency conditions, because as you'll see, it will be the problem will be trying to decide if a certain supergravity theory it's consistent or no in a certain sense. And this is related to so-called Swampland program, which was defined, introduced by Baffa, Kuhn Baffa around 2005. And the question is the following: are all consistent quantum field theory obtainable from a quantum gravity theory like a string theory? In other words, suppose we have a quantum field theory which has satisfied all non-consistent conditions, quantum anomalies, you can quantize it correctly, everything looks fine, it's unitary, and still the question is, can you couple such a theory to quantum gravity? And the answer, and there are more and more arguments for it, is that you cannot couple to gravity any consistent quantum field theory, and the set of quantum field theories which are consistent from the quantum field theory point of view but still cannot be coupled to quantum gravity is called a Swampland, as contrasted to the what is called landscape, which is all the possible realizations in a quantum gravity framework like string theory, for example. What would be the goal of such a program is to supplement rules in effective quantum field theory with additional constraints which go beyond what we know from the textbooks of quantum field theory, beyond the quantization, absence of ghosts, unitarity, causality, anomaly cancellation. So additional rules which would guide beyond the standard model and the cosmological construction. This would be the goal. And it's a program which is still relatively actively investigated these days. Now, the framework I'll discuss today will be supergravity, because again, the main actor of my today talk will be a particle which exists specifically in supergravity, which is the gravitino, as a partner of the graviton. So the first question you'd like to ask, maybe why you are interested in such supergravity for early cosmology. The reason is the following. Supergravity, as I remind later on, is the gauge version of supersymmetry. And it's a crucial ingredient in string theory. On the other hand, if you are interested either, if you are interested, for example, in cosmology, in early cosmology, like inflation, you have super Planckian field variations. Super Planckian field variations are typical in such theories, need the ultraviolet completion. You need something which goes beyond field theory, so you need string theory. We believe that string theory is needed to understand at least some aspects of inflation, at least. And then if you need string theory, we need supersymmetry, which is a crucial ingredient. And the supergravity is just the low energy effective action in a string theory. So that's one possible motivation for supergravity. And there are various other motivations that probably some of you know. There is a deep connection between supergravity, between supersymmetry and Einstein gravity. If you make supersymmetry local, automatically you get Einstein gravity. So there is a deep connection. Now, let me remind you what supergravity is. Supergravity is supersymmetry plus gravity. If you start with the supersymmetric theory, you just add gravity, this defines the supergravity. And in such theories, you have typically, you relate by a supersymmetry bosons to fermions. For example, if you have some complex scalars, you relate the scalars to fermions and by supersymmetry. And if you add gravity, you add a partner to gravity, which is called gravitino, which will be the main actor in my today talk. Gravitino, it's an object which has a spin 3/2, was introduced well before supergravity by Rarita and Schwinger, I think 1941. And for a long time, people were interested in the consistency of field equations for gravitino and from various points of view. And the supergravity, when it appeared, they added the interesting twist on such problems, as I will mention in a moment. I'll just mention history very briefly, the history. Now, in supergravity, there is the analog of Higgs mechanism. As you know, the Higgs mechanism, we have a gauge field which absorbs a scalar, the Goldstone boson, in order to make a massive gauge field. That's the Higgs mechanism. In supergravity, there is analog super Higgs mechanism in which this gravitino, which again, it's a spin 3/2. If it's a massless fermion, which would have just two helicities, like all massless particles, no, from Lorentz representations, helicities plus or minus 3/2, it can absorb a spin 1/2 fermion, which is called the Goldstino, which again will be important today. And together we form a massive spin 3/2 particle which has four helicities, 2s plus 1 as usual in quantum mechanics. And this object has a mass which again will play an important role today. I'll not really enter into such details, but in supergravity you have three functions which are very important. Two of them enter into this mass of the gravitino. One of them is called superpotential and one of them is called chiral potential. I'll not really insist much on them, but they will enter they enter everywhere in supergravity Lagrangian. This object, it's a real function, Keller potential, which determines the kinetic terms. And this superpotential, it's a holomorphic, complex holomorphic object, which determines Yukawa couplings and the scalar potential. And they appear in supergravity as well. Now, a little bit of history. People who were interested in the very beginning, so after Rarita Schwinger introduced an action for the spin 3/2 particle, people were interested immediately in the consistency of this low energy actions for spin 3/2 field. In the 60s, Velons-Banziger pointed out that if you have a gauge field and if the gravitino is charged under a gauge field, then you have an acausal propagation in the sense that the gravitino can propagate superluminally in certain electromagnetic backgrounds. So people were, this was, by the way, a time in which people were interested in to understand which kind of particles with which spin are can be given a field theory consistent Lagrangian and propagation. When the supergravity was discovered in 1976, immediately after, of course, the question of how to avoid this problem was immediately raised. And then Deser and Zubino proved that due to the peculiarity of the supergravity interactions, there is no such problem for the gravitino propagation in the minimum supergravity. Strictly speaking, the initial arguments of Deser and Zubino did not apply to this framework of Verhoeven-Wanziger, because when you have a charged gravitino under a certain gauge field, in technical terms, you are not dealing with this minimum supergravity theory, but it's so-called gauge supergravities. And this was proved much, much later. But the result of all these papers, which span, as you see, several decades, is that in the standard supergravity theories, and I'll specify later on what standard mean, there is no problem of acausality, a causal propagation for a charged gravitino. So all the standard supergravities we know typically are safe, a standard with two derivative Lagrangians. So what I call standard are two derivative Lagrangians. And secondly, as I'll specify later on, I'm talking about standard means the usual formalism of supersymmetry supergravity, which you have the same number of both of the terminals. These are the linear realization supersymmetry, if you want. Last year, there were several conjectures and studies about the role of the gravitino in some swampland program, which I'll not discuss, but there are several of them. I'll just introduce one of them, which is related to my talk, which I'll call gravitino swampland conjecture, and there is another one which I'll not touch today. The history of the subject strongly suggests that usual supergravities, and again, I'll specify in a minute what I mean by usual, have no problem with gravitino propagation. So from this point of view, the usual supergravities don't have any constraints which would immediately put them in what I called before swampland. It doesn't mean that they are automatically fine, that they are not in the swampland. There are other swampland criteria which I will not at all discuss today. But at least from the point of view that I'm discussing today, this causality, there is no such problem with standard supergravities. Now, as I said, what I mean standard supergravity is more precisely is linearly realized supersymmetry. When you have a supersymmetry which is linearly realized, we have the same number of bosons and fermions, and supergravity is just a supersymmetry which is a gauge symmetry. So it contains also gravity. So, but otherwise is what I mean by standards, what I define as standard supergravity is just a theory which has a linearly realized supersymmetry, which has the same number of bosons and fermions. Now, in today's talk, I'll introduce a nonlinear realization of supersymmetry and supergravity. And I'll tell you why people are interested in this in recent years, in which the number of bosons is different to the number of fermions. Maybe some of you certainly know that before the introduction of standard supersymmetry in four dimensions by Bess and Zubino in 73, there were already at least two papers, one of them, which is by Volkov-Akulov, which introduced what is called today nonlinear supersymmetry. So this existed even before the standard supersymmetry. In this theory, the number of bosons, the number of fermions is different. For example, the original Volkov-Akulov theory had only a fermion, and the fermion was a Goldstone object, a Goldstone fermion of a certain symmetry, which is today you can call supersymmetry. So this even nonlinear supersymmetry is even older than usual supersymmetry by 1 year. Now, in the last 8 years or so, there were several constructions, and I did participate in the beginning of such constructions with Antoniadis, Ferrara, and Saniotti, and they were followed by Carlos Linde and several other people, to construct supergravity theories with nonlinear supersymmetry. And the reason is the following. If you are interested in doing inflation, for example, in supergravity, you have to deal with complex scalars, because if you want to have linear supersymmetry, the minimum number of fermionic degrees of freedom in four dimensions is 2, a violet Majorana fermion, and therefore you need at least a complex scalar in order to match the number of degrees of freedom on shell. This is not minimal, and moreover, for various technical reasons, usually you have 2 or even 3 complex scalars, which means 4 or 6 real scalars, which is many more that you would need to find the minimum to define a minimal inflation model. Minimal inflation model would need, for example, just 1 real scalar with the inflaton. So recently, simple nonlinear supersymmetry and supergravity models were constructed in order to construct more minimal inflationary model. For example, it's even possible to construct minimal models with only a graviton, a massive gravitino, and a real scalar, which you call inflaton. But of course, in such a theory, the number of scalar and number of fermions do not match. So in this case, so graviton has 2 degrees of freedom, inflaton 1 if a real scalar, massive gravitino has 4 degrees of freedom in 4 dimension. So certainly you cannot realize this with linear supersymmetry. You need nonlinear supersymmetry. And it's precisely this setup which I'll be interested today, because the kind of consistency condition I'll describe today apply directly to the models in which have really this minimal number of fields. Now, the way this recent model were constructed with nonlinear supersymmetry supergravity was essentially using, if you want, bringing back to light some very old proposals to use constraint, to use still the usual formalism. The supersymmetry and supergravity was today it's four dimensions. The superfields are widely used for technical reason, for technical simplicity. And the recent construction with nonlinear supersymmetry is still using this superfield construction. So in superfield constructions, by construction, you have the same number of fermions and bosons. So this fits very well with the linearization supersymmetry. Probably most of you heard about Wessenbagger, for example, book. There are a lot of other books, Friedman Frampoing for supergravity and others. So if you want to find the nonlinearizations, you have to do something. And what you can do, that's the simplest example, to impose constraints. So this is a superfield. Superfield contains, you do an expansion in some superspace, which contains, in addition to space-time, some fermionic coordinates like this theta. So you have some space-time coordinates and some superspace fermionic coordinates, a Grassmann coordinates, theta. And the components, when you expand a superfield in powers of theta, the components are fields which appear in the Lagrangian. If you don't impose any constraint, this would be a complex scalar. This would be a complex fermion. Which is the two will be related by supersymmetry. And this object is not really a dynamical degree of freedom, it's called an auxiliary field. When you impose a constraint like this one here, x squared equal to 0, if you impose such a constraint on a regular function, you would say you just get x equal to 0 and nothing else. It seems silly to impose a constraint like x squared equal to 0. In superfields, this constraint does not imply that the superfield itself is vanishing. It just implies that the scalar component is not independent. There is no fundamental scalar here, but the scalar is replaced by a bilinear in this fermion. We can easily check that if you replace this scalar with this bilinear in this fermion, which I'll call Golstino, because you will see this object will be really the object will be absorbed by the gravitino, this satisfies automatically x squared equal to 0. And as you see very well, x is different from 0. The advantage of such a simple constraint is that you can use the simplest kind of Lagrangian you have in mind. So this is Lagrangian which contains a standard kinetic term for this superfield. A simplest kind of superpotential, which is linear. This would be a completely boring free field theory without any constraint. But when imposed this constraint, this becomes a highly nonlinear theory. And it's actually equivalent to the old Volkov-Akulov Lagrange, which is highly nonlinear, actually. So you start with Lagrangian, which is essentially a free theory, you impose a constraint, and you find a highly nonlinear Lagrangian, which is supersymmetric by construction because everything is manifestly supersymmetric in this format. To give you an analogy, this is the analog with the sigma model, which we all know. Suppose you start with bosonic Lagrangian, which have n scalar components. This is so-called ON linear sigma model, in which you see here you have a vector with n components. This is manifestly has a symmetry, an ON symmetry. And as we all know, this after spontaneous symmetry breaking, this has just one massive particle, which you could call Higgs, and n minus one goes on bosons. If you take the limit when this parameter lambda goes to infinity, self-interaction goes to infinity, and you keep the vacuum expectation value fixed, you get the so-called nonlinear sigma model in which you send to infinity the mass of the Higgs particle, and you keep, of course, these Goldstone bosons, they are still there. The Lagrangian becomes just naively of kinetic terms. However, sending this parameter to infinity imposes a constraint. And this Lagrangian with this constraint describes a so-called nonlinear sigma model, which has just the linear symmetry, which is manifest is ON minus one, which rotates these minus one Goldstone bosons. And the original ON symmetry is still manifest, but is realized in a nonlinear way. So there's a nonlinear sigma model. And this Lagrangian, which seems like a boring Lagrangian with this constraint, is precisely the analog of what we are doing here in supersymmetry. So that's one simple way to realize supersymmetry. So let me go now to my main problem. My main subject is to deal with the propagation, or what I'll call spill-off sound, which I'll define immediately, in supergravity of this partner of the graviton, the gravitino, initially in our paper during inflation. But as you'll see later on, the problem is a bit more general. It has nothing to do really with inflation. It's slightly more general problem, but we realize the problem that I'll discuss today in the context of some inflation model. The spill-off sound, I'll define in a moment. It's a kind of a propagation speed of gravitinos, if you want. It has to be usually between zero and the speed of one means here the speed of light. And recently there are two big problematic behaviors which were found in peculiar supergravity models with nonlinear supersymmetry, as you'll see. All these problems which I'll discuss today, as far as I know, do not arise in standard linearly realized supergravities. First of all, it was realized actually a couple of years ago that the speed of sound can become zero at particular points in inflation trajectory. In this case, as I will just tell you qualitatively, what will happen if the speed of sound becomes zero during inflation, you can generate a very large production of gravitino, essentially unbounded propagation of gravitino, which makes maybe not a consistency problem. It's unclear if it's really consistency, if the theory is really inconsistent, but tells you that you have a large production, unbounded, so you cannot compute it anymore. You can find some severe divergences, so you have to address this issue. So that's one of the issue. And secondly, which is probably even more severe, because this one is not yet completely clear if it's a consistency condition, the second is that in some peculiar supergravity models, which are precisely these models in which we have this minimal degrees of freedom, graviton, gravitino on a real inflaton, which is the minimal kind of inflation model of supergravity, precisely in this context, for specific cases, it was found a causal behavior, speed of sound of the gravitino, which is bigger than the speed of light. So this is an inconsistency in the theory. So such a theory is probably certainly in the swamp plan because it's a causality, it's a consistency problem. Now, what I mean by speed of sound? Speed of sound is just the dispersion relation, the frequency. If when you quantize the theory, in our case is the gravitino, you quantize it as usual, you have expanding modes, you have a frequency, you have momenta. And the dispersion relation between the frequency and the momenta defines this sound speed. And here we are interested in the propagation in an inflationary or FRW background. So that's why you see here the scale factor. So the difficulty of this exercise, which I'll just show the results here, is that you are not quantizing the gravitino in a flat background. You have to quantize it in a propagating in a time-dependent background. For example, inflationary background, you have to quantize these fields like an inflation in inflationary background. You have to write the action and to quantize it in an inflation in the time-dependent background. So the gravitino, as I showed you before, has a spin 3/2 component, which I'll call later on a transverse gravitino, and a spin 1/2 component, which I'll call the longitudinal gravitino or the Goldstino component of the gravitino, if you want. And it turns out that the problem I'll discuss does not arise from the transverse component. The transverse component, even if you write the analog of the Dirac equation, if you want, in the time-dependent background, the analog of the Dirac equation, or Arita-Schlinger, if you want, becomes very simple. You have the usual Dirac part here, and the mass term is multiplied by the scale factor, just because, again, we're really in a curved background here. But this equation leads to a speed of sound which is equal to 1. If you define, again, the speed of sound like this, and you expand this in plane waves, you will find that the speed of sound is equal to 1 for the transverse spin 3/2 component. In other words, the spin 3/2 component of gravitino propagates with the speed of light. The longitudinal component satisfies a more complicated equation. And this is more complicated. And what we did is to write the analog of Dirac equation for the longitudinal component of gravitino. This one is more complicated. You have to take the full supergravity Lagrangian to find the analog of the Dirac equation for the longitudinal component. You have to define, first of all, this longitudinal component, and then you identify this object which multiplies the momentum dependent part of the Dirac equation. And from this, by using the dispersion relation, you find this speed of sound. These functions, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha, are specific functions of scalar fields in the context of supergravity. And since these scalar fields, in our case, will be the inflaton, which will depend on time, these functions will depend on time. And therefore, the speed of sound of the longitudinal component will depend on time. And typically, it's smaller than 1. This scenario is called slow gravitino. We are interested here in the extreme cases in which the speed of sound can become 0 or can become really bigger than 1, which are really very peculiar and very strange situations. So first of all, you can give a general expression in supergravity for longitudinal gravitino sound speed, starting from the expression I gave you before. And without, I could write it as a function of this function appearing in supergravity, but from the point of view of the cosmology, it's more natural to write it as a function of the pressure. Pressure is essentially kinetic energy minus potential energy, and the energy density, rho, which is essentially kinetic energy plus the potential energy, and the gravitino mass, m3/2 here, m3/2. And the time dependence, time derivative of the gravitino mass. That's an expression we can easily derive, as you see, is a sum of two positive terms. And let me discuss the first potential problem, which is the speed of sound can become 0. And speed of sound can become 0 is both of these terms are 0, and it can happen if the gravitino mass is constant, because this term can become 0 only if the time derivative of the gravitino can become 0. And therefore, m3/2 has to be constant. And the second condition you need for the speed of sound to become 0 is to have the pressure equal to 3 times the gravitino mass squared. So if these two conditions are satisfied, gravitino mass constant and the pressure equal to m3/2 squared, then you could have speed of sound equal to 0. In this case, as I said, there could be a catastrophic production of gravitino during inflation. So this was already pointed out in 2017 by a Japanese group and was rediscussed more recently by Rocky Colburn collaborators last year. precisely in the context what I call minimum model inflation, and which I'll comment later on. And the problem in more technical term is that if you look at the number of gravitino produced, this nk is the density of the spin 3/2 gravitino produced for a moment as a function of their momentum k. If the gravitino mass is below the Hubble scale, with this capital H is the Hubble scale during inflation, as you see here, what can happen that the helicity 3/2 states their production is damped to its momentum. For very large momenta, the production is damped. And then when you compute the total number of particles, you find some finite result. But for the longitudinal components, there is the production increases. It's a little bit, if you want, like the problem that Planck faced when he introduced the quantization, if you want. It's like the ultraviolet catastrophe, if you want, in some sense. The number, the density, it increases. And then if you compute the total number of particles produced, they diverge. Now we can introduce, we can give an explicit formula of this sound speed in supergravity as a function of this superpotential and carrier potential in supergravity. And the details don't matter, and I'm not insisting on the expressions, but I wrote this expression just to see that using just a very simple mathematical equality, this inequality is Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, you can see that causality is always respected. In other words, this parenthesis is always smaller than, it's always bigger than zero in all standard supergravities in which we use the standard linear realization supersymmetry, and these functions appearing here have a standard expansion supergravity. So there is never a problem of causality. So you have to work harder to convince yourself that a certain supergravity theory has a problem or not with causality. It's not the case for the standard supergravity theory with linearizations. The causality is always expected. Now, maybe I should go slightly faster on possible results. Just in words, what these people did actually is to look at the field equation of the longitudinal component of the gravitino. But actually what happens in supergravity is that if you have other fermions, then you have to be more careful. There can be a mixing between this longitudinal gravitino and other fermions. For example, if you have inflation, you have the partner of the gravitino, if the part of the inflaton. If the partner of the inflaton exists, and that's what you call the inflatino, defined like this, and this always exists in the linearizations. If you have an inflaton, you have a fermionic partner, which is called the inflatino. Unless you have no linearizations, then you have to be more careful because the longitudinal gravitino, which I'll call theta here, this the helicity 1/2 component, and this inflatino have coupled equations in a certain way. That's just coupled Dirac equation, if you want. The details do not matter anymore. But if this happens, even if what we called before the speed of sound is zero, what you really have to look is the eigenvalues of a certain matrix, which you should call now the sound speed matrix. And it's this matrix now has non-vanishing eigenstates, which means that there is no problem. There is no zero sound speed. Even if what we called before sound speed is zero, just because this is not really the physical object, you have to diagonalize if you want a Dirac equation. So in this case, there is no problem. As long as there is an inflatino in the game, so as long as you have a linearization supersymmetry, typically there is no problem with the vanishing sound speed. And actually for the large majority of supergravity model we investigate, by large majority, I mean, if there is always an inflatino, certainly there is no problem. And even if you have no linearization supersymmetry, typically, as long as the inflatino is there, you have no problem. For example, if you just impose this constraint that I discussed before, this realizes no linear supersymmetry, but the inflatino is still there, there is still no problems. The problem we found, the only problem we found is precisely in this minimal model of inflation in which the only degrees of freedom in addition to the graviton and the gravitino is a real scalar, which is the inflaton. This kind of set up uses another kind of constraints, which removes the inflatino. And in this case, indeed, you can find the inflaton does not exist anymore. This constraint removes the partner of the inflaton. The formula I wrote you for the speed of sound, the original one, is valid. And in this case, depending on the details, the sound speed can become zero indeed. So this somehow ring a bell that maybe such a setup, you have to be investigate more closely such a setup. And I don't have time to get into all details, but the overall upshot and what I'm going to say and what I'm investigating right now is that maybe you have to be careful, because not all kind of constraint superfields go easily with all with standard consistency rules like causality. For example, I'll argue later on that probably such a constraint, which people use to construct minimum model of inflation, probably its ultraviolet microscopic origin is unclear, probably. So let's for the time being assume that I can use such a constraint. Again, I can write a Lagrangian with a gravity multiplet, a multiplet here which breaks supersymmetry. This multiplet S breaks supersymmetry, which contains Golstino. The Golstino fermion is needed to be absorbed by the gravitino in this super Higgs mechanism, because you want to have a massive gravitino, not a massive gravitino. And this multiplet phi here, current multiplet phi, contains the inflaton. But when you put this constraint, and this nilpotent constraint S square equal to zero, the only degrees of freedom in the end will be graviton, massive gravitino, and the real scalar, which will be the inflaton. So that's this minimal setup, and this constraint is called orthogonal constraint, because this field is in some sense orthogonal to this nilpotent field S here. The consequences of imposing such a constraint is that there is no inflatino, the partner of the inflaton. So what I call epsilon before doesn't exist anymore. And the gravitino sound speed problem, CS equal to zero, can reappear. It's model dependent, but it can reappear. And indeed, we gave examples in which the problem can reappear. On the other hand, the Cauchy, most importantly for me, at least for today talk, I'll not really insist more on this problem, zero sound speed, but I'm more interested in the other problem. I showed you that for all standard supergravities, the gravitino propagates correctly, subluminally, but the Cauchy argument I gave you before does not apply in this case. And actually we found examples which are superluminal propagation of the gravitino, which means that these models, such models, are really inconsistent if you want they are in the swamp plant. Probably we shouldn't even invoke swamp plant, because if you have causality problems, it's an obvious inconsistency. So we don't need to invoke fancy quantum gravity arguments. The theory is certainly inconsistent. On the other hand, and that was my original interest in this, the ultraviolet origin of the orthogonal constraint was not clear. I wrote a paper, not 2006, by the way, 2016, sorry, the typo here, 6 years ago, in which we already had problems to understand ultraviolet origin of this constraint. And actually, I had a paper, strictly speaking, even earlier with Dmitry Gilencia and other collaborators, in which we already realized that there is something strange with orthogonal constraint without really understanding all of the aspects of it. So, there was already an issue of the ultraviolet origin of such a constraint, which eliminates the inflatino in particular. So again, such a pathological behavior of a superluminality is reminiscent of the swamp plant program. That's why I'm relating it to the swamp plant program, even if somehow such a behavior is simpler to discuss without needing more and more input from string theory, for example. Now, let me come back to this superluminality issue and try to give another twist. This will be just some comments. This is about work in progress with my former student, as I said, Quentin Bonfoy, and my current student, Gabriele Castagrande. And the issue is the following. So this is about this post-potential causal behavior. So that, as I said, in certain nonlinear supergravity models, in which there is no inflatino, and more precisely, it's in which you introduce this orthogonal constraint, you can have a potential causal propagation of the gravitino. And this concerns the longitudinal component of gravitino. Now, the question we are asking ourselves is the following. There is an equivalence theorem. You probably remember from the gauge theory, there is an equivalence theorem between the longitudinal component of a gauge field and the Goldstone boson. And the equivalence theorem for the is saying that at high energy, you, if you are interested in the longitudinal, let's say W propagation, if you want, WW scattering, let's say at high energy, you can replace the longitudinal component of W by the corresponding Goldstone boson. That's called equivalence theorem. There is a similar equivalence theory for the gravitino. At high energy, the longitudinal gravitino component is described by the Goldstino, is captured by the Goldstino, and the Goldstino coupling to matters is not Planck suppressed, whereas the transverse gravitino coupling to matter is 1 over m Planck, which is normal because it's part of the graviton, if you want. The interactions of the spin 3/2 components, the Goldstino, is not really 1 over m Planck, but it's 1 over the scale of supersymmetry breaking. The same is, there is a similar statement in gauge theories, which is well known. So the question is, suppose you take a supergravity theory, you decouple gravity, so we are talking about now a standard rigid supersymmetry theory with the Goldstino couplings to this scalar, which was called inflaton in supergravity. So we don't have any more supergravity theory, it's just a standard supersymmetry theory coupled to a scalar, which was inflaton in supergravity. Can you understand, is there this acausality which was present in supergravity with supergravity techniques from a purely supersymmetric arguments? And the answer is yes, and that's what we are trying to, that's what we understood recently with my students. You don't need really supergravity, and this acausality, potential acausality problem of the longitudinal component of gravitino is not really is not really specific to supergravity. You can even take the mass Planck to infinity and you still have the same problem. And this, to me, it's an interesting twist of this problem. So if you take the low energy Lagrangian, and again, this is not any more a supergravity Lagrangian, as you see here, don't have any more Planck mass. F is a scalar supersymmetry breaking. You decouple gravity, but still you have a Goldstino, which is, if you want, the longitudinal component of gravitino. The longitudinal component of gravitino, the Goldstino, is captured by this low energy Goldstino Lagrangians, and the original Lagrangian in this limit contains a higher derivative like this. A higher derivative term, which has a coefficient which is proportional to 1 minus the sound speed squared. And actually, it turns out that this operator is subject to some constraints, which are called positivity constraints. This constraints is a very, very old subject known in the 60s, 70s, using dispersion relation arguments, analyticity, causality, and crossing symmetry. It was known that such an operator had the sign of such operator has to be positive in my convention, if you want. And this enforces the speed of sound to be less than 1. So what we checked is that if you take the supergravity decoupling limit, you look at this low energy Lagrangians, you look at this operator, and then we find exactly the same condition, the sublaminality condition, which that we originally found in supergravity. So this implies the sublaminality condition is actually more general. Is really independent of M Planck. Let me spare you the comments about. So there is an issue, in my opinion, and is that this implies that orthogonal constraint has some unphysical meaning, because if you start with a theory with two derivatives which have no condition whatsoever of causality of causal propagation. And if you just decouple some particles, for example, you decouple some scalar, you decouple some fermion, you never find any condition on the theory or any operator like this which has a wrong sign. All the time, the operators you find have always automatically the correct sign. When you decouple heavy particles, you never find any condition on low energy theory that you have to impose by hand. It's automatically implemented. So this means probably this orthogonal constraint has some unphysical, if you want, origin, or no microscopic origin. On the other hand, what is maybe, so that's one interesting, I think, twist. The other point which is maybe interesting is that on the other hand, if you want to impose this positivity condition on this operator, this usually is done by using S matrix arguments in the ground state of the theory. You need to go into ground state of your low energy theory, and you impose S matrix arguments. On the other hand, the arguments we had in supergravity doing inflation were valid on the whole inflationary trajectory, because there we discussed about the sound speed of longitudinal gravitino. During all the inflationary trajectory, the sound speed should be less than one, which strongly suggests that, for example, the coefficient of this operator, probably even the low energy, does not need to be positive only in the ground state, but more generally, probably on other kind of time-dependent solutions. So from this point of view, the supergravity condition we found is stronger than just the positivity constraints we find here. And maybe the causality condition, Gaussian propagation and time-dependent solution, maybe it's equivalent to supergravity constraint. So probably there is more than, so you can probably find the positivity conditions and operators, not just in the ground state from the usual positivity or S matrix arguments, but also either by starting from a supergravity version and you look at the something what we call inflation trajectory, or in low energy, you allow for more general time dependent solutions and essentially impose, if you have here time dependent solutions, let's say you take phi dependent only on time, you worry that the kinetic term of the Gaussian to be all the time to have the correct sign, which is a plausible condition to impose in low energy theory. So that's also maybe one way to find more constraints than just the positivity of a certain operator in the ground state. Okay, and just to finish before the conclusions, it's interesting to contemplate a kind of a conjecture. For example, in a paper the last year by Colvin collaborators, they impose a kind of a Swampland condition that in all four-dimensional effective field theory that are low energy limits of quantum gravity, and all points in moduli space, and for all initial conditions, the sound speed of the gravitino must be non-vanishing, because they only realize that there is a potential problem with the sound speed going to zero in the supergravity series they looked at. Now, since we know that you can even find acausality problems if you impose some constraints which are probably unphysical, I would define a refined version which would look like the following: at all four-dimensional effective field theory that are low energy limits in quantum gravity, at all points in moduli space and for all initial conditions, all eigenvalues of the sound speed matrix for fermions must be non-vanishing and subluminal. For vanishing, it's again, it's not necessarily a consistent condition. If you have a catastrophic production, it means that your background changes completely. It's unclear if the theory is, strictly speaking, consistent. Certainly the sound speed should be less than one or equal to one. That's certainly a consistent condition. And if you have models of supergravity in which sound speed goes higher than, bigger than one, certainly the theory is inconsistent, it's a causal. So that's these are my conclusions. So the gravitino production constraints are also important phenomenologically. I didn't insist on this phenomenological part today, but there is a long history of supergravity models and the gravitino production. And this potential problem with sound speed can be very, very small. It's an issue to be taken into account in such phenomenological viability. If you have a gravitino, if you have a supergravity model, if you produce too many gravitinos after inflation, the model is just not viable. You can destroy Big Bang nucleosynthesis. So this is a whole literature on the so-called gravitino production. But today mostly insisted on the other potential problem is that if you just look at arbitrary nonlinear realization supergravity, essentially you lose the magic properties of your standard supergravities, and you can even have acausality problems, which means the theory is strictly speaking inconsistent. So you really have to check probably both. We can argue if the sound speed has to be strictly bigger than zero or not. This is still debatable. Certainly has to be smaller than one. And the standard supergravity models certainly satisfy this, both conditions. So standard supergravities have a magic which avoid all potential problems you can imagine. When you start to nonlinearly realize supergravity, you start to lose some of the properties. And what's interesting is you can lose in particular even the causal behavior, and you can even recover problems of the type that was noticed in the 60s, this acausal propagation of gravitino in even simpler setups. Is not the original Delos-Wanziger, but even simpler setups. And technically speaking, this superluminality, subsubluminality constraints are interestingly captured by low energy Lagrangians, by pure Gaussian Lagrangians. You don't need full supergravity. And you just take low energy Lagrangians, you look at the positivity constraints, and you do capture the same condition to find the supergravity, exactly the same condition. So this condition of subluminality, it's in some sense independent of Planck. By the way, the other condition, sound speed to zero, seems to be fully dependent on Planck. So it'd be easy to understand why this limit, sound speed goes to zero, does depend on the gravity interactions, whereas this sub-superluminality conditions is strictly independent of Planck. It would be interesting to understand. There is kind of an infrared versus ultraviolet problems that would be interesting to understand slightly better. Supergravity is interesting even for this subluminality because it's stronger. You need to be subluminal in over all time dependent trajectory, not only in the ground state. This positivity understanding of this condition is interesting, but the supergravity condition is stronger because it depends on the whole time dependent trajectory. And probably it's possible to understand it also in a pure low energy theory with this Gaussian Lagrangians by searching for time dependent solutions probably. And maybe more general interest of all this, my talk would be that people became interested recently on nonlinearization of supergravities for application to cosmology. And before, for example, with Antoniadis, Dumitru Ghilenciu were interested on applications on low energy physics and nonlinear supersymmetry. And it seems to me that there are constraints on this nonlinear supergravities, supersymmetry theories coming from such constraints on sound speed, which means that not everything goes. Not all nonlinear realization of supersymmetry goes without any price to pay. So some of them are probably inconsistent. In particular, these minimal models of inflation, in my opinion, have to be amended in some way, which now we understand, I think, to a large extent. This is a work in progress. We can understand how to make them completely insensitive to such problems, but you have to change something in the theory in order to avoid potential causality. Okay, these were my conclusions. Thank you very much. And again, thank you very much for the invitation to give a talk in such a nice SEENET seminar series. Thank you.
Thank you, Emilian. Thank you very much. Now our time for questions. Maybe we will give an advantage for the people who are not exactly from the Southeast Europe, but we like them as that they are from. So I will give now a flag to Borut Bajc.
Okay, thank you very much. Very nice talk. I had the following question. You mentioned this nonlinear sigma model that you can get as a limit of a linear sigma model. Can you get the nonlinearization of supersymmetry or supergravity in the same way? And what are the constraints? Yes. I mean, how you get the constraint?
Yes. For example, to get this constraint, for example, mm-hmm. what you can do is to start with a theory which has, in addition to this, you can start with a term which has something like x squared, x bar squared in the Keller potential. This contains interactions of Goscinny, and you send, for example, the coefficient of this term to be very large, for example. This, when you write the field equations, if you take the coefficient to be very large, it will enforce this constraint here. And that's very similar to this, if you want. Now, this is well understood for this constraint. Mm-hmm. Initially, it was argued that was a paper by Komagoski-Sabe that maybe you don't even need to take the coefficient to be very large. I think in supergravity, you need to take the coefficient to be very large for technical reasons. For other constraints was also understood. Now, that's precisely the comment I made here, probably very obscure comment I made here. If you try to do the same understanding for this, what I call orthogonal constraint, we don't know how to do it starting with a two derivative Lagrangian in ultraviolet. So what I would call a microscopic Lagrangian, so start with a two derivative supersymmetric Lagrangian, maybe take some coefficients to be very large, like in nonlinear sigma model, and then you find the constraint. For this orthogonal constraint, we are unable to do this. We are forced to start with a higher derivative Lagrangian directly in the ultraviolet. That's why I said that this is obscure.
Thank you.
And that's why I believe that this orthogonal constraint is peculiar compared to others.
Okay, thank you. Emilian, is it the super gravity is completely free and this inflation related to the supersymmetric gravitational model is completely tachyonic free?
Yes. Yes. No, the models have had apparently no pathologies before. And actually, even, if you are a very conservative, and I would personally...
No, I'm not.
No.
I'm joking.
Well, you could say that even if you use this constraint, I didn't write, there is a condition to be satisfied. You can impose a speed of sound to be less than one. And okay. This is the condition on some functions appearing in what is called superpotential. So you could say as long as this, there are some conditions to be satisfied, then you could live with this. And that's the attitude of people which, people didn't realize that there is a superluminality problem, but you could say that as long as you satisfy these constraints, you can live with such models. And maybe there is a condition on the initial conditions, for example, you start with some initial conditions such that this speed of sound is always less than one. I believe that an ultraviolet Lagrangian, which was two derivative, in which you integrate out heavy particles and you find a low energy version with a constraint, should not have any conditions to be imposed ad hoc way by hand. The Lagrangian, the low energy Lagrangians automatically has all operators with the right behavior such that there is no post potential causality problem. That's my viewpoint. And therefore, I believe that using certain realization, nonlinear realization supersymmetry, in which you have some conditions on the functions to be satisfied, is unnatural. So you should start with a setup in which no condition whatsoever should be imposed on the Lagrangian. That's my viewpoint.
Okay, thank you.
That's possible to do, but you have to change something.
Any other question? Ioannis, please.
Hi, Emiliano.
Hi, Ioannis.
How are you? Just a very simple question. I mean, your results are quite general and they give serious restrictions on supergravities and so on. Of course, we know that we have several string theories or at least several manifestations of string theory. Does these results give a hint regarding a phenomenological realization of, let's say, supergravity in string theory, or, you know, is there some feedback?
Well, not really. Not really. Of course, I always have in on the back of my mind string model with broken supersymmetry, because yes, this setup with nonlinear supersymmetry is really string theory with supersymmetry broken at the string scale.
Yes.
And as you know, this was one of my main subjects with Antoniadis, with Saniotti.
That's why I asked, yes. That's why I asked. I know you have this in mind for sure.
Yes. Now, I don't yet have immediate intelligent comment to be made. The only comment I would make is the following. Such a theory, of course, this theory with broken supersymmetry at the string scale have their own issues to be solved, because there are various issues in such theories to be understood. But I believe that the effective Lagrangian of such theories automatically will generate higher dimensional, higher derivative operators, but they should have, I think, automatically the correct sign. So I believe that in such theories, probably you should avoid using such orthogonal constraint starting from a two derivative Lagrangian, because that creates really these conditions. But I cannot say more than that. Would be probably interesting to take explicitly string theory, compute some higher derivative terms like for example, something like that, for example, operator like that. That's possible in strings with nonlinear supersymmetry. So again, we know, as you know very well, we have string theories with nonlinear supersymmetry, realization supersymmetry. I think it would be interesting to compute operators like this and to check that the signs is automatically the correct one. I'd be very surprised to get some conditions on the moduli fields. On this would be very strange, because it would mean that such a string theory would be in some sense in the swampland. This would be very strange, but it would be an interesting check, I think.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, if there is no further question, I would like to thank to Emilian, first of all, and to all of you for participation, and to the people who help in organization of this event. Emilian, you will be contacted by the colleagues for the slides of the presentation.
I can send you slides, yes.
We expect that there will be one more lecture in June, and after that there will be a summer break, and likely we'll continue in the autumn. I would like to remind all of you that SEENET-MTP workshop will be from 2nd to the 4th of September in Belgrade, and after that we will continue with the SEENET-MTP school, and all that is a part of the Balkan Physics Union Congress. And you will get some further information in the future. So till the next seminar, and hopefully on site in September, I would send best regards from myself and from my colleagues from the CNET office and from Yanis as well. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you again. Bye. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, Emilian.
Bye.
Thank you.